This is Tetsuo Sakurai, playing a Yamaha Broadbass 2000 bass guitar. Sakurai was the co-founder of Japanese jazz fusion group Casiopea, and its bassist in its first phase. I discovered Casiopea soon after I started learning bass guitar 2 years ago. What stood out to me was the tone of this bass. How does the BB2000 have such a distinct tone? It all boils down to pickups, the pickups being these parts here. Pickups are magnets which pick up the vibration of the metal strings and convert them into an electrical signal. By configuring pickups in a certain orientation, the tone of the bass changes. The 2000 has a unique pickup type and configuration, reversed P pickup and blade J pickup. Both pickup types, in isolation, are generally uncommon, but to have them both on one bass is an extremely uncommon combination. After a certain point in time, I decided that it was time to get that BB2000 tone for myself. Unfortunately, buying a 2000 is really impractical since the lowest price is around $1,500. It's a vintage bass which was sold until the late 80s. The only options you have are buying a cheaper bass like a BB7 and upgrading some parts. Even then, it's a tough sell. Elbow grease and stars aligned are your only option. I had been looking for a suitable donor bass until March. That's when I stumbled upon a listing on Facebook Marketplace of a Yamaha BB424X, which was only going for $250. I snagged it as soon as I could. It felt like highway robbery getting it for that price, though. It had many, many benefits. The BB body shape, the neck profile, the rare blade J pickup, which you really can't find anywhere, and the five-piece neck, and the pickup switch as well. Obviously, I had a few issues, the big one being the non-reversed P pickup. Also, it didn't have the control cavity access on the top, unlike the 2000. It wasn't even the right color. My ideal 2000 is a sun or cherry burst, and this one was gloss black. Other miscellaneous changes which had to be done were changing the headstock label, changing the string tree, the tuning machines, removing the pickguard, filling the holes where the screws for the pickguard were, and repainting parts and 3D printing parts. That's a lot of work to get to a final product, but here we are. The first thing I did was remove the pickguard. I didn't need it. Actual BB dials cost upwards of $40 each, so I had to compromise and buy some Gibson speed dials, which look sort of close to the BB dials. It was a better option than keeping the chrome ones, though, on the BB424X. The next thing I looked for was new tuning machines. The 424X comes with clover-shaped ones, but the 2000 has unique heart shapes. You can't find them anywhere. Aftermarket ones don't exist, and only vintage BBs from the 300 until the 2000 have them. You could buy a cheap 300, swap them, and resell it, or just find the tuners. Somehow, at that exact time, a listing of a full set of BB300 tuners popped up. It was $50, and all four were in reasonable condition, so it was an instant buy. With the tuners shined up and installed, the next step was to work on the body. I removed all the parts from the body, unsoldered the pickups from the controls, and removed the neck. Since I had to change the color of the 424X, I had to remove the paint somehow. Now, with no experience, I went to Instinct, and Instinct told me use sandpaper. So I used sandpaper, and it didn't do much. I did get down all the way to the wood, but it wasn't very easy. So the next thing I did was get a heat gun and a paint scraper. It did a really good job at removing the poly finish, but none of the paint underneath. So I turned to the internet. The internet told me get an orbital sander, so that's what I did. And within a few days, I sanded down all the paint. It was really interesting to see firsthand, especially for someone who's never really done this before, to see how different grits affect wood differently. It was also really interesting to see how many layers there are of stuff underneath the poly finish. Now, I sanded it down from 40 grit all the way to 240 grit and eventually 320 grit, but the one place I didn't sand was around the string holes. I left that alone because I wanted to maintain some of the original color as a reminder of the process from start to finish, but the real reason is because it was really hard to sand down there, even with an orbital sander and even by hand. A lot of this project was based on luck, finding the 424X, finding the tuners, and now dimensions. Dimensions are really hard to come by on the internet, especially for vintage, uncommon basses like the 2000. By complete chance, a user on the Vintage Yamaha BB Facebook group sent many dimensions to the group. I got in touch with him and he sent me even more dimensions, along with a headstock label. I modified the dimensions slightly and modeled the pickup ring, covers, and cavity in SolidWorks with his dimensions. I sent the files over to my friend, who printed a prototype pickup cover, and it fit like a glove. Even now, I'm not sure how the adjustments were that perfect. Clearly, I don't know a lot about wood and woodworking. Someone who does know a lot about wood and woodworking is my grandfather. Without him, this project would have gone very sideways. He helped me in such a big way, so the biggest thanks go to him. We first started off with the control cavity. Since access to it is supposed to be on the bottom, we had to chop off the bottom piece, and that was a reasonably smooth process. He then made a new piece to slide into the top of the cavity. The 2000's controls are in a slightly different position than the 424X's, so he drilled out new holes in closer spots to the ideal positions. With the controls in the right place, the pickup cavity was next. I've never used a router, so it was only proper to let my grandfather route out the P-pickup cavity. He made the cavity one big rectangle, with a few slip-ups, but I like it better that way as it adds some humanity to the body. He made the replacement parts for the mirrored corners, smoothed out the bottom of the cavity with some epoxy, and cleaned up the edges. The biggest part of the job was done. If you asked any of my childhood friends about my artistic ability, they'd tell you a lot about the overfed albatross and the malnourished polar bear, two of my most famous works in art class, which I fortunately can't show you. That's a testament towards how bad I am at art. So I had to squeeze out every ounce of whatever creative juice I had in my unused ability in order to paint this base. Speaking of my friends, it's important to note that I was originally going to paint this base with the help of my friend Nahee. Before we met to paint it, I gave it a shot though, and the result was passable. I will say though that the advice I got from her was very, very valuable. Go subscribe to her channel Copper Coin Stories, and the link to it will be in the description down below. All the painting was done using Rit dyes, who are not the sponsor of this video. They're water-based dyes which are really easy to mix and easy to use. I started with the two lines which run through the whole body of the BB2000. Since the 2000 is one piece, there's no removable neck, so the lines are supposed to run consistently from one end to the other. Obviously, that's not the case with the 424X, so I had to paint the lines on it. Next was the body, and since I wanted a stained sunburst color scheme, I had to use two colors and blend them together in the middle. For the outside, I used a dark brown cherry red blend, and for the inside, I used a sunshine orange and neon yellow blend. Because they were water-based dyes, blending the colors together was really easy. All I had to use was a paper towel, and I swirled them together until the blend was in the right spot and had the right gradient. After a few coats of paint, it looked like this. Finally, the last bit of painting that I did was using this, which is shielding paint. If you ever use this, I'll warn you in advance, it stinks. I don't think I've ever smelled anything worse. If you get any on your hands, it'll be there for a few days and you'll regret it. It was necessary though. I repainted the body lines and gave it a final inspection. I taped up the important parts of the body and started the finishing process. The first few coats were with this, which is a clear gloss lacquer spray, and it didn't work as well as I had hoped, so instead I used this, which is a clear gloss polyurethane spray. It worked a lot better than the lacquer. Finally, I put a coat of wax on the body. It's shiny, obviously not as perfect as a factory-built guitar, but I'm happy with it. It looks old, and that's what a BB2000 is, so it all works out. It's not a BB2000 without the headstock label. Initially it said Yamaha, but I scrubbed that off easily with some dish soap and a sponge. I printed the new label on a clear laminate sheet with adhesive on the back, layered it with another adhesive sheet just to keep the print intact, cut it out, and stuck it on the headstock. Now it's a broad-based 2000, or at least it is on the headstock. Speaking of the name, I wanted to name it something slightly different. Obviously it's not a stock BB2000, so I had to pick something unique. It's definitely still a BB, since it has the silhouette and the features of a BB. It's still a 424X in some respects, because it has the neck through capability. It's also a 2000 though, since it has the Blade J pickup and the reversed P pickup. So what's a good name for it? I settled on BB42K. There's something from everything. BB,
42 and K would make it BB42000 in full, but that's a little too long. Plus, the number 42 holds some personal significance for me. I think it's the perfect name. With the help of my brother, what I mean is he did most of the work, we resoldered the controls and it worked on the first try, surprisingly enough. No electrocution, no interference, no problems. I reinstalled the bridge, knobs, and string tree, and the job was almost over. This whole project started with the pickups, and that's how it ended. Because the P pickup is supposed to be reversed, I needed a new pickup cover. The same friend who printed the prototype pickup cover also printed a second cover along with a ring. The pickup mounting method in the 2000 is different than the 424X. On the 424X, the pickups mount to the body, on the 2000 they mount to the ring. With this method, the pickups can mount relatively closer to the strings to get that all-important tone. With the parts now printed, I couldn't resist checking out the new tone. On top of the new configuration, I bought a set of Labella Deep Talking Bass flat-wound strings. They're the first set of flat-wounds I've ever bought. I know they'll mellow out soon, but for now they sound perfect. I restrung the bass and played around a little. The new configuration shows its true colors when you pop on D and G. It's so bright, forward, and perfect. After I had had my fun testing it out, I spray painted the covers and the ring and reinstalled them. To top it all off, I had bought a pickup switch which had the right color ring tip. I swapped out gloss black for cream white, and the BB42K was now complete. No guitar project breakdown is complete without a sound demo. Here are some comparisons from before the project started, along with the final tone.
Thank you.
This project taught me a lot about working on guitars, and I'm looking forward to the next project, whenever or whatever that might be. To finish off the video, here's a partial cover of Casiopea's Domino Line, originally played by Tetsuo Sakurai on the Yamaha BB2000. Thanks for watching.